اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين آمين. صدق الله العظيم وصدق رسوله النبي الأمين الكريم ونحن على ذلك لمن الشاهدين والشاكرين. چونکہ مجھے تو کوئی موضوع نہیں دیا گیا اور مجھے یہ بتایا گیا تھا کہ میں آخر میں تقریر کروں گا، تو میں نے یہ سوچا کہ پہلے دو تقریریں سنوں گا، اس کے بعد جو سمجھ میں آئے گا وہ آپ لوگوں کے سامنے پیش کروں گا. لیکن حضرت نے مجھے پہلے ہی کھڑے کر دیا. اب میں یہ سوچ رہا ہوں کہ جو حضرات کو موضوع دیا گیا وہ اپنے مضامین اپنے مواد تیار کر کے آئے ہیں، تو اگر میں کوئی ایسی بات کہہ دوں جو وہ کہنا چاہتے تھے تو یہ غلط ہو جائے گا. لیکن اب حضرت نے کھڑے کر دیا تو جو سمجھ میں آئے گا وہ پیش کرتا ہوں. اگر کوئی تکرار ہو جائے گی تو اعلیٰ حضرت فرماتے ہیں کہ زیادت خیر زیادت ثواب ہے. یعنی جو بات مقدر کہہ دی جائے، اور یہاں تو ثواب ہی کی بات ہو رہی ہے، تو جو بات مقدر ہو جائے گی تو اس میں زیادہ ثواب ہے. اگر آپ حضرات کو درود شریف یاد ہو تو ایک مرتبہ درود شریف پڑھ لیں. ان بخاری شریف سیدنا حذیفہ رضی اللہ تعالیٰ عنہ عمر رضی اللہ تعالیٰ عنہ امیر المومنین سیدنا عمر رضی اللہ تعالیٰ عنہ سیدنا عمر رضی اللہ تعالیٰ عنہ announced amongst the صحابہ کرام that were present at that time. He said, أَيُّكُمْ يَحْفَظُ أَحَادِيثَ الْفِتَنْ مِنْ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ. Which one of you remembers the ahadith that the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم mentioned regarding fitan? Fitan is the plural of fitna, trials and tribulations. Sayyidina Hudhayfa رضي الله تعالى said that I came forward and I said, Ana, I remember the ahadith that the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم mentioned regarding fitna. فتنة الرجل لماله ولولده ولأهله ولجاره تكفرها الصلاة والصيام والصدقة. He says that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that after I will leave you, the Muslims will fall into fitna due to their wealth, due to their children, due to their families, and due to their neighbors for not fulfilling their rights. However, the fasting, the prayer and the giving in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the sadaqah, will compensate for them fitna. Sayyidina Amirul Mumineen Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu ta'ala, he says that, O Hudhayfa, I am not talking about those fitnas that will be compensated by fast, prayer and by sadaqah, ولكن الفتنة التي تموج كموج البحر. I am talking about those fitnas that will flow like a massive tide from an ocean or a massive wave of an ocean which will take he whoever comes in front within it.
मैं उन फितनों की बात नहीं कर रहा हूं कि जिनका कफारा नमाज रोजे और सदका से हो जाए बल्कि उन फितनों के बारे में पूछ रहा हूं कि जो एक समंदर के मौज की तरह बहे और जो भी सामने आए उस पर डर जाए तो हुदैबा رضی اللہ تعالی عنہ says that ya amir al mu'minin ma'am I remember them hadith however why do you worry about such fitna why do you worry about such fitna فَإِنَّ بَيْنَكَ وَبَيْنَهَا بَيْنَهَا وَبَيْنَكَ بَابًا مُغْلَقًا For surely, between you and them fitan, there is a door which is locked, a door which is closed.
يعني O Umar, O Amir al-Mu'mineen, between you and them fitan, there is a door which is closed. You don't need to worry about them fitan.
But he says, سَيُفْتَحْ سَيُكَسَّرْ However, that door will soon break. People will break that door and the fitna will flow from that door. So when Sayyidina Hudzaifah radiallahu ta'ala mentioned this hadith in front of his students, Imam Masrooq, in Bukhari Sharif it says, Imam Masrooq, one of his students, he asked, O Hudzaifah, O our teacher, did Umar know, Akana Umaru Ya'lam? Mahmul Bab, did Umar radiallahu ta'ala know what that door was which was stopping the fitna from flowing amongst the Ummah of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? The Hudzaifah radiallahu ta'ala replied, yes, Umar radiallahu ta'ala knew very well what that door was. He knew what that door was in the same way as he knew that tomorrow comes after today. And then he says that door was Umar. The door was Umar himself. When Sayyidina Umar radiallahu ta'ala passed away, fitna began to flow. Umar radiallahu ta'ala was the door that held fitna from the Ummah of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And Umar radiallahu ta'ala asked Hudzaifah, that did the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam say, Sayyukassar or Sayyuftar, will the door be opened or will it be broken? The Hudzaifah radiallahu ta'ala said, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, it will be broken, people will break that door. The zalimeen, the transgressors will break that door. The Umar radiallahu ta'ala said, that how I wish the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, the door will be open. If it would have been open, we would have had hope that it can be closed again. But if the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, that it will be broken, then there is no hope of that door being closed again. Which tells us that fitna and fitan will continue until the day of judgment upon the ummah of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. In the time of Uthman al-Ghani radiallahu ta'ala, many fitnas occurred. In the time of Sayyidina Ali radiallahu ta'ala, many fitnas occurred. Fitna continued in the time of Imam al-Hasan radiallahu ta'ala, in the time of Imam al-Husayn radiallahu ta'ala, and it continued in the time of Imam Azam Abu Hanifa radiallahu ta'ala, in the time of Imam Ahmad bin Hanbal, in the time of Imam Ahmad Raza radiallahu ta'ala, until today fitnas are spreading and new fitnas are occurring in front of us. And they are all targeting our iman. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, in those days when fitna will spread among the ummah, al-qa'imu ala al-haq, كَالْآخِرِي فِي كَفِّهِ الْجَبْرَةِ A person who remains steadfast on the truth in them days will be like a person who holds a hot red piece of coal in his hand. That is how hard it will be to remain upon the truth. Because the person who will be on the truth, people will call him a fitna. People will say that he is causing people to divide into sects. People will say that this person is causing fitna. Did people not say that Imam Hussain radiallahu ta'ala is causing a fitna? Imam Hussain radiallahu ta'ala is causing the ummah to divide, ma'azallah.
In the time of Imam Hussein radiallahu ta'ala, the people who followed Yazid, they said that to Imam Hussein radiallahu ta'ala whilst he was in the battlefield of Karbala. It wasn't even a battlefield, the field of Karbala. Imam Hussein radiallahu ta'ala was blamed for causing a fitna, ma'azallah. And that has continued until today. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that when a person in them days will walk past the grave, he will say to himself, Ya laytani kuntu makana. How I wish I was in the place of that person in the grave. For he has left this world with Iman. And we are still being tested. We are still going through a trial and tribulation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Our Iman is still being tested. Every day, every hour that we live, our Iman is being targeted. And we need to protect our Iman. And in the same way as you protect yourself from gaining bad characteristics, you should protect yourself from losing your Iman. We don't hang around with alcoholics. We encourage our children not to hang around with alcoholics and those people who take intoxicants. Why? Because we don't want our children to become intoxicants. We don't want our children to become alcoholics. In the same way, we should encourage our children to stay away from those people who have beliefs which are against the Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah. If your child will stay and hang about with those who drink alcohol, then if your child hangs around with those who have incorrect beliefs, beliefs that show disrespect towards the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is there not a danger that he will become one of them? Of course there is. And that is the reason why the Quran says, وَإِمَّا يُنْفِيَنَّكَ الشَّيْطَانُ فَلَا تَقُدْ بَعْدَ الذِّكْرَ مَا الْقَوْمِ الظَّالِمِينَ. That when the shaitan makes you forget and you are sitting with the transgressors, the misguided people, those who are wrongdoers, then as soon as you remember, then don't sit with them. The Quran is telling us this. And when we tell people this, people are saying, you're causing division in the ummah. You're causing fitna in the ummah. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, the ummah is like a whole body. The ummah of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is like one body. When one part of it feels pain, the whole body feels that pain. If the ummah is a whole body, then tell me, if one part of the body becomes infected, we try to remove that infection. We try to get rid of that infection. And if there's no possible way of getting rid of that infection and that infection is spreading, the only one solution is to cut that part of the body up and throw it away. For if you don't, then the whole body will become infected. In the same way, the ummah of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is a whole body. And when one part of the ummah of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam becomes infected with incorrect beliefs, then we try every way to cure them beliefs, to correct them beliefs. And if there's no possible way, then we regard that part of the ummah as not part of the ummah. That is the only way we can keep the ummah of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam united. That is unity. And including all these infections and incorrect beliefs within the ummah of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is causing division within the ummah of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And that is why one of the usul of the deen, one of the usul of Islam, is to call a non-believer a non-believer. To call a kafir a kafir. Because when a person commits kufr, and apparently he lives amongst the Muslims, and he calls himself a Muslim, his kufr is absolutely clear that we have the ummah, the whole body, which has kufr inside it, which is an infection. Kufr and Islam cannot join together. And therefore you have to regard that as kufr and the person as kafir and regard him as outside the ummah of the Prophet Muhammad. This is for the sake of unity. And if you look at the battle of Karbala, when Imam Hussein radiallahu ta'ala was in front of an army of 22,000 followers of Yazid, according to narrations in the books of history. First there were 2,000, and then an army of 4,000 came, and then more came. Altogether there were 22,000, and Imam Hussein radiallahu ta'ala was with 72 or 82 followers of it on one side. Who was on the truth? Without doubt, Imam Hussein radiallahu ta'ala was on the truth. The ahadith of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam foretold us that Imam Hussein radiallahu ta'ala will be on the truth. He was on the truth, yet he was only a minority. Yazid and his followers were the majority. 22,000 of them against him. When they called the adhan for prayer, Imam Hussein radiallahu ta'ala didn't answer that adhan. When they called the iqama, Imam Hussein radiallahu ta'ala did not answer that iqama. When they performed salah, Imam Hussein radiallahu ta'ala did not pray behind them. None of his followers prayed behind them, even though they were in the minority. Imam Hussein radiallahu ta'ala had his adhan called separately. His iqama was called separately. They performed salah separately. And he showed to the world that you must stand on the truth at all times. Whether you are in minority, if you are the truth, then stand firm. Because the truth can never join with false. That is the lesson that Imam Hussein radiallahu ta'ala taught us. And Imam Hussein radiallahu ta'ala did not join with the people of Yazid, did not give his hand in the hand of Yazid. Why? Because Yazid was a wrongdoer. Yazid was a person who openly committed sins. He drank alcohol openly. He allowed his followers to drink alcohol. He had corrupt actions. Imam Hussein radiallahu ta'ala did not give his hand into his hand. And yet today people tell us, okay, why don't you join with these people? Why don't you join with the people of these other sects? Why don't we all unite together? Have we forgotten that Imam Hussein radiallahu ta'ala not only gave his own life, but the lives of his children, the lives of his relatives, the lives of all of his followers, for the sake of unity? That is what unity was, to remain steadfast on the truth and never to give your hand into falsehood, never to join with falsehood. Unity can only happen with the truth. Unity cannot happen with falsehood. This is the lesson that Imam Hussein radiallahu ta'ala gave us in Karbala. We listen to what happened in Karbala every year. These are the lessons that we need to take from them. That is reality. It is the truth. Imam Hussein radiallahu ta'ala did not give his hand into the hand of Yazid. He gave his life away. Mard-e haq باطل سے ہرگز خوف کھا سکتا نہیں, سر کٹا سکتا ہے لیکن سر جھکا سکتا ہے. Are we not on the truth? The followers of the correct Ahl Sunnah wal Jamaah, those who follow Imam Ahmad Raza رضی اللہ تعالیٰ, those who are known as the Bareilis, are we not on the truth? Of course we are on the truth. Then if we are on the truth, then why should we bow our heads towards falsehood? Why should we unite towards the wrong? Why should we unite with these other sects? This is what unity is. People don't understand what unity is today. People hold unity conferences. They hold movements like Unity Foundation, but they don't know what unity is. They say Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, hold on to the rope of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala firmly. We should all hold on to the rope of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Why are you Maribis moving away for? Things like this they say. They don't understand what the verse of the Quran is saying. Hold on to
the rope of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala firmly. Firmly means with both your hands. Dono haatho se, mazbooti ke saath. Taake phisal na jaye. Hold on to the rope of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala firmly with both your hands. That is what Imam Hussain radiallahu ta'ala said. He held on to that rope of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala so firmly that he did not let it go. His children died, his family members died, but he did not let go of that rope. He held on to it. Why? Because the Yazidis, they weren't holding the same rope. They were holding another rope. And if Imam Hussain radiallahu ta'ala tried to join with them and hold their rope at the same time as holding the rope of Allah, then that wouldn't be following the command of Allah, because Allah says firmly, and holding a rope with one hand and another with another hand is not firmly. Na idhar ke rahenge, na udhar ke, adhar ke rahenge. That is what unity is, to hold on to the rope of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala firmly. And that is what Imam Hussain radiallahu ta'ala did. And his message to the world was that I am holding the rope of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I am united on the truth that has come to us from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is your duty to leave whatever rope you are holding and come and hold the same rope as I am holding. That is what the verse of the Quran means. Hold on to the rope of Allah firmly. In the time of Imam Ahmad bin Hanbal radiallahu ta'ala, even in the time of Imam Azam Abu Hanifa radiallahu ta'ala, many fitnas occurred. People said that the Quran, the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is a makhluk. Imam Azam Abu Hanifa radiallahu ta'ala said, no. The word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is an attribute of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The word of the speaker is his attribute, and the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are not a makhluk. The Quran is not a makhluk. The book form and the ink and the paper we have, that is a makhluk. But the actual word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not a makhluk. Imam Azam Abu Hanifa radiallahu ta'ala was put into jail because of that. But he held on to that rope of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He did not divide the ummah of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam into that fitna. But he remained united on the correct belief. In the time of Imam Ahmad bin Hanbal radiallahu ta'ala, the very same fitna rose again. Imam Ahmad bin Hanbal radiallahu ta'ala announced amongst the people that the Quran is not a makhluk, it is a sifa, it is an attribute of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and therefore it is not a makhluk of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it is an attribute of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He was taken to court. Imam Ahmad bin Hanbal radiallahu ta'ala was put into jail. Imam Ahmad bin Hanbal radiallahu ta'ala was brought in front of the king at that time, and he was lashed with a whip on his bare back. His qamis was taken off, his garment was taken off, and he was whipped on his back. But Imam Ahmad bin Hanbal radiallahu ta'ala held on to the rope of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala firmly. He would be struck with a whip and he'd be ordered that say that the Quran is a makhluk, and he would say the Quran is not a makhluk. And he would be with him. He'd be told again, he'd say again that the Quran is not a makhluk of Allah. The Quran is the sifat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He was whipped, but he held on to that rope of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He stood alone and he showed to the world that if you are in a place where the majority are on the false and you are on the truth of your own, then don't hesitate. Don't let your legs become loose. Stand firm. Stand firm, because this is holding on to the rope of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala firmly. In the time of Imam Ahmad Raza radiallahu ta'ala, many fitnas occurred. Many fitnas occurred. In the same way Imam Ahmad Raza radiallahu ta'ala stood firm on the truth. People called him many names. People said he favors the British. People said he is a mushrik. People said he believes Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to be God, ma'azallah. Many people wrote letters in which there were swears towards Imam Ahmad Raza radiallahu ta'ala. But he didn't hesitate. He stood firm and he held on to the rope of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is unity. And today we hold on to the rope of Ahlul Sunnah wal Jamaah, the correct Ahlul Sunnah wal Jamaah. And we will hold on to that firmly. And today there are many different ropes that people are holding. Everyone holding a different rope says we are the truth, we are the truth. But the truth is the Ahlul Sunnah wal Jamaah is those who follow Imam Ahmad Raza radiallahu ta'ala. According to those people familiar with the subcontinent. And we are holding on to the rope of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We cannot unite with the other sects present today. But it is upon those sects to leave their ropes and come and hold the rope of Imam Hussain radiallahu ta'ala, the rope of Imam Abu Hanifa radiallahu ta'ala, the rope of Imam Ahmad bin Hanbal radiallahu ta'ala, the rope of Imam Ahmad Raza radiallahu ta'ala. This is what unity is. Even today, there are people who say that we are the Ahlul Quran. Until today, this fitna rose many, many years ago. It was there in the time of Imam Ahmad Raza radiallahu ta'ala. People who say that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was nothing but a postman, ma'adallah. His duty was simply to bring the message from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and give it to the people. Ma'adallah. Everything is mentioned in the Quran. We don't need anyone else. We don't need any hadith. We only need the Quran, and the Quran is enough for us. People still today believe this. The fitna is still there. They call themselves the Ahlul Quran. And every fitna that comes in front of you, they will come with a beautiful name. They will not come and say that we have come to misguide you. Or we have come to take away your iman. We have come to take away the love you have for the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We have come to move you away from salah. That's not what they say. They come with beautiful names like the Ahlul Quran, the Ahlul Hadith. People come with beautiful names. People call themselves Ahlul Sunnati wal Jama'ah. And they come to misguide us. Suna jangal raat andheri chhai badri khali hai. Sone walo, those people who are gold, sone walo, jaagte rahi ho, choro ki rakhwali hai. We're in the jungle. Where there is darkness, fitna. Those people who are gold, sone walo, stay awake, jagte rahiyo, choro ki rakhwali hai. The gods that are protecting the place, that are guarding the places today, ye sab chor hai. They all thieves, they will rob your iman, they will take away your iman. And it's surprising, from what I've seen, they only come to misguide the Ahlul Sunnah wal Jamaah. They only come to misguide the Sunnis. I have never heard of a person from Tablighi Jamaat or Jamaat-e-Islami or from the Devbandi sect going to the house of a Shia to make him into a Devbandi. Never. I've never seen a Ghair Muqallid go to the house of a Shia to let me make the Shia into a Ghair Muqallid. They always come to the house of Sunni. Why? चोर वही जाता है जहां माल होता है. जहां सोना मिलेगा वही ना चोरी करेगा. जहां सोना ही नहीं माल ही नहीं वहां क्या चोरी करने जाएंगे. तो सोने वाले तो हम लोग हैं. वी आर द वन टू हैव ईमान. और वो भी जानते हैं दे नो एज वेल यही लोग हैं ईमान वाले. ईमान लूटना है तो इन्हीं के पास जाइए. इन्हीं के दरवाजे से दस्तक दीजिए. ये हाल है. तो Ahlul Quran, believe in the Quran, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We don't need the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Beliefs like this, Imam Ahmad Raza radiallahu ta'ala fought against these beliefs. How can you follow the Quran without following the hadith of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam when the Quran itself commands you, كَمَا أَتَاكُمُ الرَّسُولُ فَخُذُوهُ وَمَا نَهَاكُمْ عَنْهُ فَانْتَهُوا. أَتِيُوا اللَّهَ وَأَتِيُوا الرَّسُولَ مَنْ يُطِعِ الرَّسُولَ فَقَدْ أَطَاعَ اللَّهَ. مَا أَرْسَلْنَا مِنْ رَسُولٍ إِلَّا لِيُطَاعَ بِإِذْنِ اللَّهِ. We have not sent the messengers but so that you follow them. Follow Allah and follow His messenger. He who follows the messenger of Allah has followed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. مَا أَتَاكُمُ الرَّسُولُ. Whatever the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gives to you, take it. Whatever he makes halal, take it. Believe it to be halal. Whatever he forbids you from, whatever he makes haram, stay away from it. What does it mean? It means that we have to follow the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ مُسْوَةٌ حُسْنَةٌ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent a message to us, and with the message Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent his messengers, his prophets, who showed us the way to act upon the messages of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and made them uswa hasana for us, role models for us to follow the ways of them. Otherwise, how can we know what the Quran is commanding? For example, one verse. وَإِنْ لَمْ تَجِدْ مَاءً فَتَيَمَّمُوا سَيِّدًا طَيِّبًا. If you don't find water, then perform tayammum with pure earth. What does that mean, if you don't find water? If you've got water, and a person holding that water, he owns that water and he refuses to give you that water, does that mean you can't do tayammum anymore? Because pani na mila hai. If you have water in a well and you have no apparatus or no instruments to remove that water from the well, you found water but you have no access to that water, so what then? The Quranic verse says, if you don't find water, then do tayammum. We have found water, what do we do now? We can only understand this from the hadith of the Prophet Muhammad. In Ibn Majah, there's a hadith of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam that once a Sahabi in a battlefield got injured, his head got injured, a very deep wound on his head. After the battle, at night when he went to sleep, he woke up in the morning, he had to do ghusl, he had to perform ghusl. To perform ghusl, he asked the Sahaba ikram. They discussed amongst themselves and they said, you will have to do ghusl with water. Because the verse says, if you don't find water, you didn't find water. Therefore you will have to. He performed ghusl with water, he passed away. Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. Sahabi of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam passed away. When the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam received the information, the news regarding this, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, قَتَلُوهُ. They have killed him. قَتَلَهُمُ اللَّهُ. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala kill them. Yani those people who gave him the wound in the battlefield. And then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, أَوَلَمْ يَكُنْ شِفَاءُ الْعَيِّ السُّؤَالِ. Is the cure of ignorance, of not knowing something, to ask? All you had to do was ask. If you don't know something, then the cure to that is to ask. All you have to do is ask. And from the hadith we learn that illam tajid ma'an means illam taqdir ala istimal al-ma. If you do not have the capability on using the water, that is what the verse means. We can only understand this from the hadith of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So this fitna is like this. And then there's the fitna which calls themselves Ahlul Hadith. All we need is Hadith, we don't need anything else. Khalas, sirf Hadith. A munazara happened many years ago, after the time of Imam Ahmad Rizal radiallahu ta'ala, in the time of Mufti Azam Hind radiallahu ta'ala, where followers of Imam Ahmad Rizal radiallahu ta'ala had a debate with those who call themselves Ahlul Hadith. They gathered together, they sat on each side, and they agreed that we shall write the names of the books that we will believe to be authentic according to us. They wrote the books. The person who was in the middle, the judge, he was a Nawab, a rich nobleman from the place where the debate was taking place. When he received the piece of paper we had, which had the names of books according to the Ahlul Hadith, he saw and he said to them, okay, add one more book into this list. Add one more book into this list. They said, no. These are the books that we believe are authentic. We don't believe any other book to be authentic. He said, please just add one more book. Ek hi to kitab hai. Bada dijiye. He said, nahi. Humne banaya deen ka mamla hai. Deen ke mamle mein aapki khwahish ke liye banaya nahi jayega. He said, bada dijiye. Just add one more book on. So the ulama from the Sunni side said, kya maamla hai, what's going on? Chhod dijiye, agar wo nahi maante, na maane. So he says, kare, on your list, aapki fehrist mein likha, sabse pehle Quran, aur inki list pe pehle likha Bukhari. قرآن لکھا ہی نہیں ہے تو جب قرآن ہی کو نہیں مانتے تو مناظرہ کا کیا فائدہ صرف حدیث کو مانا اور جو بھی حدیث صرف بخاری میں یہ اہل حدیث اور اہل حدیث کہتے کھولنے مطلب اہل حدیث وہ خیر ہوتا ہے حدیثیں کتنی یاد ہیں ہاں بھائی احادیث بھی دینو they don't even know Arabic most of them and they call themselves اہل الحدیث how can they be اہل الحدیث when they don't even know Arabic they have to be مقلد of those who translated the hadith without that it's impossible لیکن کیا معاملہ ہے ان کا پانچ مسئلے پہ عمل کر لو تو اہل حدیث ہاں نماز کے لیے اس طرح کھڑے ہو گئے تو اہل حدیث شیخ سلیم مینشن یوزولی کہ وہ فٹ بال میں کرسٹیانو رونالڈو جیسے فیلڈنگ لے رہا ہے اس طرح کھڑے ہو جاتے ہیں نماز کے لیے تو یہ مسئلے پہ عمل کر لیا اہل حدیث یہاں ہاتھ باندھ لیے دوسرا مسئلہ سینے سے اہل حدیث زور سے آمین بول دیا پہلے حدیث میں رکوع سے پہلے رکوع کے بعد ہاتھ اٹھا لیے اہل حدیث میں اور امام کے پیچھے قرآن کر لی پہلے حدیث پانچ مسئلے recite the Quran behind the imam say Ameen loudly when you put your hands in salah in qiyam then put them on your chest and when you stand with your legs apart then you end the hadith صرف پانچ مسئلے پر عمل کر دیا اہل حدیث after that چاہے چوری کرے زنا کرے ڈکیتی کرے جو کچھ بھی کرے شراب پیو اہل حدیث بس پانچ مسئلے پر عمل کیا نا ختم اہل حدیث یہ معاملہ ان لوگوں کا that's what's going on حالانکہ if you look at the حدیث تو حدیث میں کہاں ہے they don't know what احادیث are ان سے کہیں کہ حدیث کے مطابق اگر ایک رکعت نماز بھی پڑھ کے دکھا دیں without going against any other حدیث تب جا کے اہل حدیث کہلانے کے مستحق لیکن کوئی نہیں پڑھ یہاں سے ہاتھ باندھ لیں گے تو یہاں کی حدیث ہے یہاں سے ہاتھ باندھ لیں گے یہاں کی حدیث کیسے عمل کریں how can they act upon every hadith of the Prophet Muhammad صلی اللہ علیہ وسلم it's impossible they can't how can they without knowing the knowledge of اصول حدیث اصول فقہ ناسخ منسوخ عام خاص مطلق مقید all these things how can they act upon the hadith of the Prophet Muhammad صلی اللہ علیہ وسلم جیسے آمین زور سے بولو حدیث کے مطابق کہاں حدیث کو لکھا ان مسلم شریف کئی حدیثوں میں ہے Prophet محمد صلی اللہ علیہ وسلم said اذا قال الامام غیر اذا قال الامام غیر المغضوب علیہم ولا الضالین فقولوا آمین فإن الامام يقولها when the imam says غیر المغضوب علیہم ولا الضالین then all of you say Ameen because the Imam also says this why did the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam say because the Imam also says if the Imam said it loudly then everyone knew that the Imam says Ameen there was no need to tell the people but because the Imam used to say Ameen quietly the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam informed the people that I the Imam also say Ameen at that time You don't hear it because I say it quietly. And in the Quran it says, "Udu Rabbakum tadarruan wa khufyatan." When you make dua to your Lord, then do it quietly. And in Bukhari Sharif it says, "Qala Ata'u Ameen du'a'un." Imam Ata said that Ameen is a dua. If Ameen is a dua, and the Quran says that when you make dua to Allah, then you should do it quietly, then the Quran is telling us that you should say Ameen quietly. And in another hadith, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, إِذَا قَالَ الْإِمَامُ غَيْرِ الْمَغْضُوبِ عَلَيْهِمْ وَلَا الضَّالِّينَ فَقُولُوا آمِين مَنْ وَافَقَ قَوْلُهُ قَوْلَ الْمَلَائِكَةِ فَقَدْ غُفِرَ لَهُ مَا تَقَدَّمَ مِنْ ذَنْبِهِ So when the Imam says غَيْرِ الْمَغْضُوبِ عَلَيْهِمْ وَلَا الضَّالِّينَ then you should say Ameen. Whoever is Ameen, resembles the Ameen of the Malaika, or is the same as the Ameen of the angels, then all of his sins are forgiven. Now how can you make your Ameen the same as the Malaika, the angels? Does anyone hear the Ameen of the angels? You don't hear the Ameen of the angels, which means the angels say Ameen quietly. Which means we should say it quietly. Sadguna Mahaprabhu. So this is what the hadith says. So hadith pe amal karna chahiye, tab ja ke ahle hadith kehlayenge. Kehte imam ke piche qiraat karo. They recite the Quran behind the imam. In the Jahri namaz, in the namaz when the imam speaks loudly, we listen to the Quran. We don't pray behind the imam. The Quran says, إِذَا قُرِئَ الْقُرْآنُ فَاسْتَمِعُوا لَهُ وَأَنْصِتُوا. When the Quran is being recited, then listen attentively and remain quiet. To remain quiet, listen attentively, which means remain quiet. Listen to the imam, don't do your own qira'ah. Qira'atul imam qira'atullah. He who prays behind an imam, so the imam's qira'ah is qira'ah for him. Since the imam's qira'ah is his qira'ah, then there's no need for him to do qira'ah. In Muslim Sharif, Sayyidina Abu Huraira radiallahu ta'ala said to those present in his time, the Sahaba Kiram and a few Tabi'een, he said, مَنْ صَلَّى صَلَاةً وَلَمْ يَقْرَأْ فِيهَا بِأُمِّ الْقُرْآنِ فَصَلَاتُهُ فَهِيَ خِدَاجٌ 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 غَيْرُ تَامٍ. He who performs salah and he doesn't recite the Umm al-Qur'an, the mother of the Qur'an, which is Surah al-Fatiha, then his salah is خِدَاج 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 غَيْرُ تَامٍ. It's incomplete. It's naqis. It's not complete. Then you must recite Surah Fatiha when you perform Salah. In Muslim Sharif, when Abu Huraira radiallahu ta'ala mentioned this, those that were present, they said, نَحْنُ وَرَاءَ الْإِمَامِ أَحْيَانًا. Sometimes we perform Salah behind the Imam. How can we recite Surah Al-Fatiha? So Abu Huraira radiallahu ta'ala replied, he didn't say you should still pray. He said, اِقْرَأْ فِي نَفْسِكَ. Recite it in your heart. Not on your tongue. Your lips shouldn't move, your tongue shouldn't move. Iqra' fi nafsik. Recite Surah Al-Fatiha in your heart. This is what the hadith says. The Ahl al-Hadith of those who follow the hadith of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And this is what the hadith of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Then there's a firqa who call themselves Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah, and the ulama of some Deoband. Yabir Ibn Ahmad. These people have the same type of belief as the Ahlul Hadith. However, these people are very, apparently, in their apparent actions, very similar to us. They follow Imam Azam Abu Hanifa radiallahu ta'ala. They will perform Isar al-Sawab. They will do Fatiha. They will believe the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is Noor. They will believe the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had ilm al-Ghayb. They will believe that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is alive today. They will believe it is permissible to say Ya Rasulullah. Yet at the same time, they will believe it is shirk to say Ya Rasulullah. It is shirk to believe ilm al-Ghayb for the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It is shirk to believe that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is still alive. It is shirk to do Isar al-Sawab. Just recently I read a fatwa, Isar al-Sawab, shirk, from a Deobandi scholar. He wrote that Isar al-Sawab is shirk. That food upon which Isar al-Sawab has been done is shirk. It is haram to eat that food. Ye fatwa, Abi Alika. In that fatwa, it said, these people who do Isar al-Sawab, their intention of doing Isar al-Sawab is apparent. Why? Because they only do it on biryani, on sweet, on burfi. These are the only things they do Isar al-Sawab on. Their intention is apparent. Their intention is they like to eat. This is what it said in the fatwa. Why don't they do Isar al-Sawab on clothes? Why don't they do Isar al-Sawab on raw food like wheat and barley? go to the factories and do Isal Islam? Why don't they do Isal Islam on earth, land, plots of land, and give them to the poor, send the reward to your deceased? Why don't they? They only do it on food. Yes, Allah. Shirk khana. We answer, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in Muslim Sharif there's a hadith which says, إن الشيطان يستحل الطعام إن لم يذكر اسم الله عليه. Verily, the food upon which the name of Allah has not been recited becomes halal for the shaitan. And in many hadith of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that food upon which the name of Allah has been mentioned becomes haram for the shaitan. Abhuliyah, biryani, is pe isale saab ne kya iska naam lete hai? We don't take the name of Firaun. We don't take the name of football player. We take the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on this food. Yahi to isale saab hai, Allah ka naam uspe lena. That is what isale saab is. And we have seen, maine to Hindustan mein dekha hai, ke khud bhi khate hai. بلی کو کھلایا بلی نے کھا لیا, مرغی کو کھلایا مرغی نے کھا لیا, گدے کو کھلایا گدے نے کھا لیا, سب نے کھا لیا, دین بندی کو دیا تو شرک حرام. اب کیا مطلب ہوا حرام کس کے لیے؟ حدیث تو کہہ لیے کہ شیطان کے لیے وہ حرام, جس پہ اللہ کا نام دیا گیا وہ شیطان کے لیے حرام. اب سب کھا رہے, پوری دنیا کھا رہی ہے, جانور بھی کھا رہے, لیکن کون نہیں کھا رہا؟ سب کہتے ہیں صرف کھانے ہی پہ اشارے صاف کرتے ہیں. میں کہتا ہوں یہ تو کچھ مروت ہم نے رکھی ہے آپ کی, دس از اے فیئر بابل. کپڑے پہ اشارے صاف کریں گے کپڑا بھی حرام ہو جائے گا آپ کے لیے. اور کپڑے کی فیکٹری میں جا کے پورا کپڑا پہ اشارے صاف کر دیں گے تو ننگے پھریں گے. کھانے کی فیکٹریوں میں جا کے اشارے صاف کر دیں گے تو پھر بھوکے مریں گے. تو ایسے فتوے نہ لکھتے تو بہتر ہوتا. نگاہ کی فتوا ہمارا جواب بھی ایسے ہی ہوگا. There are many hadith of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam which prove the permissibility of Isal al-Sawab. The more, one of the most famous hadith, Bukhari Sharif ki hadith, Hazrat Sa'd رضی اللہ تعالیٰ عنہ, حضرت سعد رضی اللہ تعالیٰ عنہ said, ان ام سعد ماتت, she has passed away, ای الصدقۃ افضل یا رسول اللہ, which is the most superior way of صدقہ to send reward unto my mother, the messenger of Allah. فقال الماء water, فحفر بئرا. حضرت سعد رضی اللہ تعالیٰ عنہ had a well dug, and فقال هذه لأم سعد, this well is for the mother of Sa'd, she has passed away. اشار ثواب پانی پہ, وہ پانی سب صحابہ پیتے تھے, ان کے لئے حرام. بخاری شریف میں a female جہید from جہیدہ came to the Prophet صلی اللہ علیہ وسلم, my mother has passed away, is there any way? She had the desire of performing Hajj. Ya Rasulullah, can I perform Hajj from her? The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Hujji minha, perform Hajj from her and the reward will be her. A man came, in Bukhari Sharif again, a man came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Ya Rasulullah, my parents have passed away, is there any way I can send reward to them? The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, when you perform Salah, then pray Salah for them as well. Yani send the reward of your own Salah to your parents. When you fast, fast for your parents as well. Send that reward to your parents as well. Yeh hadith keh rahi hai. This is what the hadith says and this is what we follow. Yeh hai aqidah Ahlus Sunnat wal Jamaat. Bareliyon ka aqidah. Aur yeh log, jisme bhi Nabi ki taaleem hai, wo shirk hai. Aala Hazrat farmate hain, کہ شرک ٹھہرے جس جان شرک ٹھہرے جس میں ہاں شرک ٹھہرے جس میں تعظیم رسول ہاں شرک ٹھہرے جس میں تعظیم رسول یعنی whatever in every way that we respect the Prophet Muhammad صلی اللہ علیہ وسلم they regard that as shirk اس کو شرک ٹھہرا ہے شرک ٹھہرے جس میں تعظیم رسول اس برے مذہب پہ لعنت کیجئے کیسا مذہب ہے کہ اس مذہب میں تعظیم رسول کو شرک ٹھہرایا گیا کھڑے ہو گئے رسول اکرم صلی اللہ علیہ وسلم کی تعظیم کے لیے تو شرک نبی کا علم غیب مان لیا تو شرک نبی کے نام سے انگوٹھے چوم لیے تو شرک شرک ٹھہرے جس میں تعظیم رسول اس برے مذہب پہ لعنت کیجئے عجیب قسم کا مذہب ہے قرآن شریف میں اللہ سبحانہ وتعالیٰ نے فرمایا کلو و شربو کھاؤ اور پیو کوئی قید نہیں بیٹھ کے کھاؤ کھڑے ہو کے کھاؤ چلتے پھرتے کھاؤ کوئی قید نہیں یہ حدیث شریف میں قید ہے بیٹھ کے کھانا سنت ہے ٹھیک ہے کھڑے ہو کے کھانا حرام نہیں سنت کے خلاف مکروہ لیکن قرآن میں تو کوئی قید نہیں ہے اسی طرح قرآن میں ہے صلو وسلمو درود بھیجو سلام بھیجو یا ایھا الذین آمنوا صلوا علیہ وسلموا تسلیما اور دو بھی سن سالیٹیشن اور پیس اپن دی پروفیٹ محمد صلی اللہ علیہ وسلم سن صلاۃ و سلام اپن دی پروفیٹ محمد کوئی قید نہیں کھڑے ہو کے چلتے پھرتے بیٹھتے اٹھتے کوئی قید نہیں لیکن یہ لوگ قید لگاتے ہیں کہ بیٹھ کے کرو کھڑے ہو کے کیوں کرتے ہو کیوں بس شرک تعظیم رسول ہے تو شرک اعلی حضرت فرماتے ہیں کہ قل یا عبادی کہہ کے ہم کو شاہ نے اپنا بندہ کر لیا پھر تجھ کو کیا جب اللہ نے قرآن میں فرمایا یا عبادی او مائی پروفٹ او مائی بیلوڈ او محمد صلی اللہ علیہ وسلم سے ٹو دا پیپل سے ٹو دا بلیور یا عبادی او مائی سرونٹ So when Allah has mentioned in the Quran that all of us are ibad of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, so when we make ourselves the slaves of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we shirk kehte hain. If we keep our name Abdul Mustafa, we shirk kehte hoge. Kehte Abdul Mustafa naam shirk hai. You will never find a difference with the name Abdul Mustafa. Kyunki wo shirk samajhte hain. In Bukhari Sharif, Umar Farooq radiallahu ta'ala says that three different times came upon me. First time is before I accepted Iman upon the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. At that time, I thought to myself that if I die, I will go into Jahannam. With certainty. The second time was when I accepted Iman upon the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam on the deen of Islam. Kuntu abda. I was his servant. Abda. Yani Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam ka abda. Abdul Mustafa. I was Abdul Mustafa. At that time, I knew with certainty that I was going to heaven. Ya ibadi keh ke humko shah ne apna banda kar liya phir tujhko kya? Subhanallah. Aur najdi marta hai ki kyon taazim ki? Ala Hazrat farmate hain, when we do taazim, when we respect the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, ye marte ki kyon kar rahe ho? Kyon kar rahe ho? اللہ سے فرماتے ہیں کہ نجدی مرتا ہے کہ کیوں تعظیم کی یہ میرا دین تھا پھر تجھ کو کیا میرا دین ہے تجھے کیا تیرا تو دین ہی نہیں ہے تیری دوزخ سے تو کچھ چھینا نہیں خلد میں پہنچا رضا پھر تجھ کو کیا کئی اور عقائد ہیں کئی اور کتنے ہیں My message simply to you is that stay firmly upon the path of Ahlul Sunnah, the correct Ahlul Sunnah wal Jamaat. Remember, even today, everyone calls themselves Ahlul Sunnah wal Jamaat. He who is not a Shia or Qadiani, majority of the rest of them, they all call themselves Ahlul Sunnah wal Jamaat. Shia, another very dangerous fitna amongst us today. What did they believe? Tamam sahaba kafir, ma'azallah. ان کے ایک میر باقر ہے حق الیقین نام کی کتاب لکھی ہے حق الیقین نیم آف دا بک میر باقر ہی رائٹس ان دیٹ بک کہ آفٹر جب رسول اکرم صلی اللہ علیہ وسلم اس دنیا سے وفات پا گئے تو سب صحابہ کرام مرتد ہو گئے سوائے تین سب مرتد سوائے تین مقداد سلمان فارسی رضی اللہ تعالیٰ عنہ اور ایک اور یاد نہیں ہے نام، ان میں حضرت علی رضی اللہ تعالیٰ عنہ کا بھی نام ہے، تو وہ بھی مسلم امام حسین رضی اللہ تعالیٰ عنہ کا بھی نام ہے، سیدہ فاطمہ رضی اللہ عنہ کا بھی نام ہے، سب مرتد ہو گئے سے تین رہ گئے معاذ اللہ. حالانکہ دا قرآن کلیئرلی مینشن کہ رضی اللہ عنہم ورضوا عنہ، Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is pleased with them. كُلَّ وَعَدَ اللَّهُ الْحُسْنَى. Every one of them, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has promised them Jannah. How can you go into Jannah if you have lost your iman? Every sahabi of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has been promised to go into Jannah. أُولَٰئِكَ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ حَقًّا. Every one of them are upon the truth. But these people, they swear at every one of them. And Amir Muawiyah radiallahu ta'ala, a sahabi of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Many of our Sunnis falling prey to these fitnas, they begin to feel ma'adallah hate towards Amir Muawiyah radiallahu ta'ala. This is incorrect. Remember, Imam Hassan radiallahu ta'ala gave khilafah into the hand of Amir Muawiyah radiallahu ta'ala. And if he gave khilafah into his hand, then that means Amir Muawiyah radiallahu ta'ala is on the truth. And the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that he will do sulah between بين الفئتين العظيمتين من المسلمين. In one narration it says العظيمتين as well, the azmah of iman, two groups of Muslims, Amir Muawiyah radiallahu ta'ala was without doubt the Sahabi of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu ta'ala was once asked about Amir Muawiyah, one of his actions. And Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu ta'ala said, in Bukhari Sharif, the words are, innahu alal haq, he is on the truth, fa innahu faqih, because he is a faqih. He is a faqih, a jurist. He has the level of ijtihad. He performs ijtihad, and the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, إِذَا اجْتَهَدَ مُجْتَهِدٌ وَأَخْتَأَ فَلَهُ أَجْرٌ وَاحِدٌ. When a mujtahid performs ijtihad, and his ijtihad is incorrect, he still receives one reward. وَإِذَا أَصَابَ فَلَهُ أَجْرًا. Sayyidina Ali radiallahu ta'ala's ijtihad reached Isaba, it was correct. For him there were two rewards. Amir Muawiyah radiallahu ta'ala performed ijtihad according to the Ahlul Sunnah wal Jamaat, he still receives one reward. He was a Sahabi. And Abdullah ibn Mubarak radiallahu ta'ala, one of the greatest students of Imam Azam Abu Hanifa radiallahu ta'ala, the author of Nibrah, the Sharah of Sharia Qaid al-Nasafi, and Mullah Ali Qari in the Sharah of Mishkat Sharif, they both mentioned that Abdullah ibn Mubarak radiallahu ta'ala was asked by a person, who is more afdal, Amir Muawiyah or Umar ibn Abdul Aziz radiallahu ta'ala anhuma. Umar ibn Abdul Aziz was the first mujaddid of Islam, a very, very great personality of Islam. He did many things for the religion of Islam to reach us today as it is. But when Abdullah ibn Mubarak radiallahu ta'ala was asked this question, he replied, غُبَارٌ دَخَلَ فِي أَنْتِ فَرْسِ مُعَامِيَةَ حِينَ غَدَى فِي رِكَابِ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ أَفْضَلُ مِنْ كَذَا عُمَرَ بْنِ عَبْدِ الْعَزِيزِ. The dust which entered the nose of the horse on which Amir Muawiyah radiallahu ta'ala rode side by side with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the battlefield is more superior than an Umar ibn Abdul Aziz like this. That is the status of a Sahabi of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the Aqeelah of the Ahlul Sunnah wal Jamaat, the ulama of Ahlul Sunnah wal Jamaat say that when a Sahabi is stood in the place of punishment for fornication and he is about to be stoned to death, then at that time, whilst he is being stoned to death, he is still more superior than any other non-Sahabi, no matter how great a wali of Allah he is. That is the status of a Sahabi. How can a person swear at a Sahabi? How can a person have hatred towards a Sahabi? The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, he who loves my companions will love them because of me. He who hates my companions, he will hate them because of me. He who loves my companions loves me and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He who hates my companions hates me, and he who hates me hates Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We are on the truth. We should be proud of being on the truth. Kya raza aaj gali suni hai, uth mere dhoom machane wale, We should be proud that we follow Imam Ahmad Raza radiallahu ta'ala. We should stand firm on the truth. We should stand firm, and when people invite us to join with the wrong, then we should say Al-Kufru Millatu Wahida. Kufr is all one group, but the truth is always separate from kufr. We are the truth, we will stand firm. Unity is for us to stay together, not to unite with false. We do not mix with false. That is the truth. That is what we should follow. This is the lesson of Karbala and every other incident in the history of Islam. This is the lesson that all of our predecessors have given to us. Stand firmly on the truth. Hold firmly the rope of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And always fear that people are out there to take away your iman. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect our iman. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala keep us on the truth. Make us steadfast upon the truth. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala keep us following the predecessors. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us death only and only with iman. Jazakallahu khairan. Assalamu
alaykum.
MashaAllah, subhanAllah. Janab Hazrat Allama Mufti Muhammad Zahid Sahab. مجھے اب ایسا محسوس ہوتا ہے کہ بہت ہی اچھا کیا. سب سے پہلے میں نے ان کو مائک پر لا کر کے آپ کے سامنے کھڑا کر لیا. فجر واقعی میں ان سے وعدہ ہوا تھا آخر کا, لیکن جیسے ہی آئے پتا نہیں حضرت نے کس بو سے کہہ دیا کہ میں تقریر نہیں کروں گا. میرے دل میں آیا کہ آخر کا تقریر تو سننی ہے, کیوں لوگ پہلے ہی کھڑا کر دوں. جب کھڑا کیا تو پھر انہوں نے میرا دل باغ باغ کر دیا, اور جو الفاظ انہوں نے کہے تھے تو کہا کچھ بھی ہو جائے کیا پورا ایک گھنٹہ دوں گا. میں کہا کہ آپ کے لیے اجازت ہے, اور آپ نے واقعی میں ایک ایسی تقریر سنی, اور خاص کر میرے نوجوان آج نئی نئی فطروں میں بچ رہے ہیں. اور اسی لیے میں کہتا ہوں قرآن و حدیث کو سمجھنا اور یہ پڑھنا ہوگا. جاہل لائق پڑھ سکتا ہے سمجھ نہیں سکتا, اور آج لوگ وہ ٹکڑے ٹکڑے کر رہا ہے دین کے اپنی جہادت سے, اور ہمارے اکثر یہ سمجھ رہے ہیں کہ وہ چھوڑ رہا ہے. وہ جاہل بھی ہے شاطر بھی ہے, اس کے ساتھ میں لائق بھی ہے. پلیز ایسی چیزیں سننے سے پیشتر ایسے علماء اہل سنت و جماعت جو آپ کو بہتر اپنی زبان میں سمجھا سکتے ہیں, آپ ان سے کانٹیکٹ کریں, ان سے رابطہ کریں, اور آپ اپنے ایمان کو صحیح معنوں میں مضبوط کرنے کی کوشش کریں. مجھے لگتا ہے کہ آپ دفتر دے رہے ہیں تھکے ہوئے ہیں. اچھا کوئی بات نہیں, آپ کی تھکان دور کرتا ہوں, کھڑے ہو جائیں. میرے جو بزرگ ہیں ان سے میری گزارش ہے کہ نہیں, لیکن کھڑے ہو جائیں. آقا کی بارگاہ میں میں جو